Thank you. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's symposium jointly presented by our Hong Kong Foundation and the Center for Health Systems and Policy Research at the JC School of Public Health and Primary Care at the Chinese University of Hong Kong's Faculty of Medicine. My name is Dan Ting. I'm an assistant researcher at the Public Policy Institute of our Hong Kong Foundation and your MC today. To kickstart today's symposium, may I first invite the convener of non-official members of the Executive Council of the Hong Kong SAR and Vice Chairman of our Hong Kong Foundation, Mr. Bernard Chan, to give his welcoming remarks. Mr. Chan, please.
Chief Executive, the Honorable Carrie Lam, Professor Sophia Chan, Professor E.K. Yeo, distinguished guests, on behalf of our Hong Kong Foundation, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to you all. We are particularly grateful to our Chief Executive for taking time out of her very hectic schedule today to join us. It shows how much our Chief Executive cares about the health of the people of Hong Kong. Indeed, over the last 5 years, the government's recurrent expenditure on public health has gone up by 55%, which far exceeds the growth in GDP, far exceed the growth in total government expenditure, and far exceed all key economic and financial indicators. The big jump in government expenditure on our health is money well spent. Today, the people of Hong Kong enjoy the longest life expectancy in the world, second to none. Despite the often cited inadequacies of our healthcare system, Hong Kong people, on average, are expected to live beyond 85 years. And celebrating our 85th birthday and 95th birthday is certainly great news. But for a public health system, it is also a great challenge to cater to this aging population. As each of us age, our individual healthcare needs change. And as collectively our population ages, the demand pattern for healthcare changes and the pressure points on our health system changes. And that's why we have with us today the Hong Kong best public health policymakers and experts like Secretary Sophia Chan, Professor Yeo, Dr. Low, Dr. Feng, Mr. Fan. We also have leaders from private sector healthcare like Dr. Lee and Dr. Chan. We also have experts in health finance, experts in health insurance, leaders from our health disciplines, leaders from the patient groups. I can go on until I read out the entire guest list. The theme for today is primary healthcare. But the journey that brought us here actually started 3 years ago. Back in 2018, we launched a policy paper on primary healthcare. It was rated by the University of Pennsylvania's annual Global Think Tank Index as the best policy study report. That report put our Hong Kong Foundation firmly on the map of top global think tanks. I am delighted to see quite a few faces among us today who had helped us author that award-winning report 3 years ago. A key expert is, of course, Professor E.K. Yeo, a dear friend and distinguished member of our foundation's research council. He is the mastermind behind a series of our health-related research reports that chart the way forward, a fit-for-purpose health system enabling health for all. But the award-winning report 3 years ago was itself the brainchild of a group of visionaries back in the year 1990. At the time, a government working party on primary health care conceived a seminal policy paper entitled Health for All, The Way Ahead. That report foresaw a more equitable health system in Hong Kong, pointing out the crucial role of primary care in an overarching public health system. And since then, the development of primary care has become a key policy objective of the government. You will be pleased to know that the brain behind that visionary report in 1990 is also with us today. And that time, that champion of primary healthcare was just a young secretary of that working party. That young evangelist of primary care is none other than our chief executive, Carrie Lam. Thank you, Mrs. Lam. From the 1990, now let's fast forward to the near future. Primary care is now very much on the ground in the community. Only last week, we celebrated the launch of the latest District Health Center Express in Tai Po. The vision for primary care has now become a groundbreaking momentum that makes healthcare to the doorstep of those who need it most. And it is not just District Health Center. The government will soon unveil the blueprint on primary health care. And this is all happening because of the efforts by our chief executive and from all the health care leaders sitting here this afternoon. Today, our latest research report focuses on how to use strategic purchasing as a public health policy tool to optimize both the quality and the quantity of healthcare for the people. Professor Yeo and other experts will share their insight with us. We will also hear from three renowned field experts, Mr. Henry Fang, Professor Donald Lee, and Mr. Tim Peng, who will shed lights from their distinct perspective of medical professionals, service providers, and patients. And before we get on to our research findings, ladies and gentlemen, please let us welcome our Chief Executive, Carrie Lam, to the stage to share with us her vision and wisdom on this very important topic. CE, please. Thank you.
Bernard, Eva, E.K., Henry, Donald, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is a great pleasure to be back speaking at a symposium organized by our Hong Kong Foundation on Hong Kong's healthcare system. In December 2016, I spoke then in my capacity as Chief Secretary for Administration at the Foundation Summit on an investment for the celebration of aging. 2 years later, in November 2018, the Foundation hosted its first Health System Summit and published a healthcare report entitled Fit for Purpose. I remember on both occasions, I consistently championed for a shift to primary healthcare in order to ensure a more sustainable healthcare system in Hong Kong. Now, coming to the last 6 months of my five-year term, I would say that my government has made some good efforts and invested more in primary health care. But definitely, there is still a long way to go to deliver a system that is affordable and fit for purpose. I therefore very much welcome another diagnosis by the Foundation under a research team led by my good friend, Professor E.K. Yeo, whose passion and drive for improving Hong Kong's healthcare system has never waned throughout these years. Today, we will witness the launch of our Hong Kong Foundation's latest health policy report entitled Strategically Purchasing Health for All, which zeroes in the aspects of financing and procurement of services to deliver the best results. On this occasion, I have not been given the privilege to preview the research findings, but in his invitation letter to me, EK has mentioned a very attractive proposition, that this healthcare research has investigated into how health financing could serve as a key strategic lever to facilitate the establishment of a sustainable primary healthcare ecosystem for Hong Kong. This is certainly music to my ears for the following reasons. Firstly, the research is premised on promoting primary healthcare, a policy direction that I have been advocating within the government since my association with the Primary Healthcare Review that Bernie has just mentioned, led by the distinguished Professor Rosie Young 30 years ago. But I was certainly not the brain for this review. I was more or less the pen to write the report. This term of government has certainly put words into actions in promoting primary healthcare, but we need concerted actions by all, including medical professionals and patients, in order to achieve a paradigm shift in service promotion, in service provision, sorry. Secondly, I have a strong feeling that the provision of a network of district health centers pressed ahead by my health colleagues diligently would not take us very far. and some further policy steer with innovation is probably needed. That said, I must pay tribute to Secretary Sylvia Chan and her team, as well as our NGO partners, for their hard work with the opening of the Kuaiqing and Samsuibo District Health Centers, and another five in 2022, plus smaller interim District Health Center Express to be set up in the remaining 11 districts, which is, of course, no small achievement, especially when the team has been fighting the COVID-19 pandemic concurrently. In my 2021 policy address, I announced that we are conducting a comprehensive review on the planning of primary healthcare services and the related governance framework, with a view to formulating a blueprint for its sustainable development. One of the major aspects that we shall look into in a blueprint is health financing. And thirdly, with rapid aging of Hong Kong's population, coupled with manpower shortage, let alone fiscal pressure, the current financing model is hardly sustainable. According to latest provisional census figures, the population aged 65 and over in mid-2021 amounted to over 1.43 million, or 19.3% of total population. And this is expected to surge to 31% by the year 2036. A survey released last Friday by the Census and Statistics Department indicated that some 24% of our total population, amounting to some 1.8 million people, had chronic diseases that required medical treatment, consultation, or medication. To enable the hospital authority to cope with this growing demand, this term of government has adopted a funding formula to calculate recurrent subvention to HA, taking account of demographic changes. As a result, recurrent subvention to HA this year amounts to $80.7 billion, which represents a 45% increase over that of 2017-18, that is, the beginning of this term of government. With these challenges at the back of my mind, I do earnestly await the release of the research findings by EK and his team. However, let me first share a few thoughts on what more we should do to ensure people of Hong Kong will continue to enjoy quality medical care. First and foremost, in my view, is research and development, R&D. Life scientists are often working hard to discover new drugs, invent new diagnostic equipment, adopt new procedures, and as in the case of fighting COVID-19, discover effective vaccines to identify abnormalities as early as possible, to reduce pain and to save lives. But there's a lot more we could do. In pressing ahead with innovation and technology development in this term of government, we have put special emphasis on health technology with the setting up of the InnoHK cluster, now housing 16 laboratories in various aspects of life sciences. We have started the Hong Kong Genome Institute, and I've announced in my 2021 policy address the establishment of an InnoLife healthcare hub at the Hong Kong Shenzhen Innovation and Technology Park in the Lok Ma Chau Loop. I have asked both the Department of Health and the HA to review their current practices comprehensively to support clinical data sharing, clinical trials, and drug registration, etc. I have also met with over 10 major pharmaceutical companies last month via a webinar to encourage them to set up research bases in Hong Kong. Second, Hong Kong is blessed with well-trained and regulated healthcare professionals. We must strengthen the roles of all healthcare professionals in the local healthcare system. As you are aware, I have since the 2018 policy address confirmed the positioning of Chinese medicine in the development of medical services in Hong Kong, and the first of its kind Chinese medicine hospital will have its groundbreaking next month. In the 2021 policy address, I have asked the Food and Health Bureau to follow up on previous recommendations to allow patients to have direct access to healthcare professional services such as physiotherapy and occupational therapy without a doctor's referral. and to explore the feasibility of introducing a statutory registration regime for those healthcare professionals who are currently not subject to any statutory registration requirements, such as clinical psychologists, speech therapists, and dietitians. Apart from protecting public interest, such efforts will enable these healthcare professionals to play a more active role in our healthcare system. Third, hitherto, any initiative to engage the private sector to provide services is restricted to within Hong Kong. However, the experience of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region government contracting with the University of Hong Kong Shenzhen Hospital to serve Hong Kong residents living in Guangdong as a result of COVID-19, which prevents traveling, has inspired us to think broader. This will particularly make good sense when there is now a one-hour living zone within the Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau Greater Bay Area, and more Hong Kong invested or Hong Kong managed medical facilities in the Greater Bay Area mainland cities. For example, a 3,000-bed teaching hospital of the Chinese University of Hong Kong in Shenzhen. When Hong Kong businesses could have seized the opportunities of cheaper land and labor across the border to move their factories northwards 4 decades ago, we should not forgo the possibility of public-private partnership across the border. This is what I called a new spatial conceptualization in coming up with the Northern Metropolis Development Strategy in my 2021 policy address. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry for making my opening remarks rather lengthy, but I hope you appreciate that this is a subject very close to my heart, as I understand how important quality healthcare is to our people. Let us now receive from EK his research findings, and I'm sure his insights will provide us with a lot of food for thought. I wish the symposium every success, and with Christmas and New Year approaching, may I wish you all good health and happiness. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Lam. We would now like to invite our guest of honor onto the stage for a group photo. May I please invite Mrs. Carrie Lam, Professor E.K. Yeo, Professor of Public Health, and the Director of the Center for Health Systems and Policy Research at the Jockey Club School of Public Health and Primary Care at the Chinese University of Hong Kong's Faculty of Medicine, Mr. Bernard Chan. Dr. Choi Duck-Yi, Undersecretary for Food and Health, Mrs. Eva Chang, President of Our Hong Kong Foundation, Mr. Henry Fan, Chairman of the Hospital Authority, Professor Donald Lee, immediate past president at the World Organization of Family Doctors, Mr. Tim Peng, community organizer at Society for Community Organization, Dr. Stephen Wong, senior vice president and executive director of the Public Policy Institute, Our Hong Kong Foundation, and Dr. Pamela Tin, head of healthcare and social development at the Public Policy Institute of Our Hong Kong Foundation. Would members of the media please wait for the second round of images? Would all guests please look at our official photographer at the front of the stage? Thank you. And now, please look at the cameras of the media at the back of the hall. Thank you. Please take your seats. Now, may I please invite Professor Yeo, lead advisor of the Healthcare and Aging Research Team and member of the Research Council at our Hong Kong Foundation, to share with us his vision. Professor Yeo, please.
Chief Executive, the Honourable Mrs. Carrie Lam, the Honourable Mr. Bernard Chan, Dr. Choi Dak Yee, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege for me to present this paper on behalf of the our Hong Kong Foundation and our Centre for Health Systems and Policy Research, which are set up by a generous donation from the Tung Foundation. It has enabled us to do more policy studies in partnership with the Foundation. I shall go through the background of this report. As Mrs. Carrie Lam mentioned, this is really a follow-up from our previous study in 2008 on a fit-for-purpose health system. In that report, we talked about the need for a person-centered care and for a primary care-led integrated care. And in order for that to be done, you needed governance and governance levers, particularly strategic purchasing. Right. And today's theme is really to go into greater depth of how strategic purchasing can enable us to have a system which will enable health for all and it's fit for purpose. The global challenges I think we are familiar is that an aging population, rising prevalence of preventable chronic disease. So the key word is preventable. It generates demands for healthcare, and there are viability and sustainability of doing more of the same. So our systems need to change, right? And this is not unique to Hong Kong. So this is the global population. The deepest bars are individuals aged over 65, and Hong Kong obviously has the same trends. And not only that, people are living longer, but not necessarily better. These are the percentage of population with chronic disease. So the on the left side are the global figures. They're almost 50% of the population have chronic disease. And on the right side is Hong Kong. Looking at the burden of chronic disease, the different bars are different age groups. So you can see that we have about half the population having chronic diseases. And not only that, we also have multimorbidity. People with more than one chronic disease. So this increases complexity. The global figures on the left, and on the right, 50% of individuals in Hong Kong, by the age they are 65, will have more than one chronic disease. And as a result of that, you have functional disabilities. So people have stroke disabilities, if not managed well. These are the ability to manage your activities of daily living, eating, bathing yourself. So there are these problems of disability resulting from poorly managed chronic disease. And on the right side are the figures from Hong Kong. So characteristics of chronic disease, which is important because the reason why we have a symposium today is about integrated care. It's a lifelong condition, which is preventable. So it's lifelong and we need to manage it. The prevention, which Ms. Lam talked about, preventing first the onset of disease through lifestyle modification, that's primary prevention. Secondary, important, early detection and effective medical care to arrest progression of disease. Tertiary, continuous, and the word here is continuous, and comprehensive healthcare to prevent complications of disease, disability, and death. Of course, and importantly, when people have these complications, rehabilitation and palliation to improve functioning and minimize suffering. First is our healthcare system, complexity and technology changes. So we have specialization. And of course, with specialization as in industry, you know, in management, you need to coordinate. So we have more people doing more specialized things, doing more on the same patient, and that requires coordination. And this is the issue about integration. And we have individuals in different settings, primary, secondary, tertiary settings, and then we have private and public providers. And of course, at the bottom are the patients or the individuals that need care throughout the life course. So a global response to this, to be fit for purpose, is to integrate health promotion, disease prevention, chronic disease management, palliation, and palliative care. must be accessible, appropriate, and acceptable for patients and individuals, because they are key in terms of optimal outcomes. So it's no use for us to have a wonderful service in our hospitals and clinics if patients don't go there, right? If patients do not trust the system, if they're not participants in the process of care, because the health outcomes are as much dependent on the patients as on the system. And health and social care coordination, connectivity. So the issue about integration is not about necessarily an organization integration, but to ensure coordination and connectivity across the different sectors within and between primary and specialist hospital care. So people-centered health service sees patients as the participants as well as beneficiaries, respond to their needs and preferences in humane and holistic ways. And integrated health services are managed and delivered, ensure people receive the continuum of services at different levels and sites. So we are providing care at different levels of care in different sites within the health system. Of course, this is not just Hong Kong doing it. Just to demonstrate from our research that there are key drivers for integrated care between countries. So these are just a few examples. So the top bar is the key drivers in increasing burden of multiple chronic diseases. The benefits of people-centered integrated care is improved health and patient outcomes, enhances quality effectiveness, reduces demand, importantly, minimizes duplication of service and care. And I'll show you some figures later in terms of the research we've done on some of our programs, improves both technical and allocative efficiency of the system, enables cost reduction. This is just the figures in Hong Kong we've seen before. Just look at the right side. On the outpatient, when people do not have a chronic disease, the utilization of private sector is about 56%, public 24%, and dual utilization 11.7%. But when you look at the second bar, when individuals have one chronic disease, they all migrate to the public sector. So 81% use public, 59% continues to be private, but you see dual utilization 44.7%, right? And then obviously we have the medical social divide. When we looked at the admissions to hospital, 15% were from residential care homes, 47% were preventable if there were good ambulatory care services, and then we have 20% readmissions within 30 days. So this is because of lack of community care. Right? So we had this conceptual framework. On the left side is the hospital care, where the private and public are coordinated, and the right side with the district health center that the government is starting, they are the focal points to the connections to the community, and then connecting, interfacing with the primary care service of the hospital authority, the private sector, and the service of the DH. So coming back to today's topic, the investigation is to how to strategically allocate healthcare resources. So purchasing is just a market term, but it's the same concept in terms of some concepts people use commissioning in the public sector. So you either make, which is commission, or you buy, which is you purchase from the market, to meet population demands. So it's really how you allocate resources to meet population demands and meet systems, objectives, and goals for a primary care-led person-centered integrated care. So our study the aim is to provide insights on best practices and lessons learned from international experience and in application of chronic disease prevention and management, identify challenges and gaps within our system, and how capacity in the private sector can be better leveraged through public-private partnerships, and assess the feasibility of a chronic disease screening voucher and management scheme. So this is specific work research that we did. And synthesize a conceptual system framework for strategic purchasing to meet system objectives and goals, which I think is a very key part of the study, which we hope will help government in terms of enabling health for all. The research design and methods, we did a review of the literature and looked at institutional documents. We did a stakeholder analysis and generated insights from them. We did a population-based survey on acceptance for the screening, economic analysis of the impact for the program that we're recommending, and then the synthesis of the findings. Strategic purchasing is one of the three functions of health financing. Obviously, it's about revenue raising, pooling of funds, and purchasing. It's seen to be a financing strategy that seeks to align funding and financial initiatives with the services for the population needs and determined by detailed information on the performance of providers. So the question in terms that when you look at that, strategic purchasing is a critical lever for allocating resources based on health needs of the population, defined by the health system objectives and goals, and determined by the scope and quality of services and the performance of providers. The goals align with the objectives of universal health coverage and to maximize health outcomes, equity in financing, and financial protection. So the question first is to determine the service that you require, and then to decide whether you make or buy, right? Whether you commission or you purchase. And obviously, the decisions must be based on assessment of the private sector and the public sector, and to see how best those services can be provided. Obviously, you can purchase from both, because in social health insurance systems, you purchase from both public and private, irrespective. So the similar concept could be used in Hong Kong as well. And importantly is who should be doing the purchasing, right? You need to identify the appropriate purchaser with capacity and to define the roles and parameters. So if government is not doing the purchasing, then you delegate it to an agency, like the hospital authority, right? So that would be a purchaser. But government itself could be the overall resource allocator. So it's a question of how best to do it. Then for whom to purchase? So I'll cover that later in terms of the parameters. It needs to be needs-based and the target population that would benefit. What to purchase, assessment of the service gaps and defined by service goals. From whom to purchase, to select providers based on capacity, availability, quality, and appropriateness to requirements. How to purchase, quite important, to decide whether you should use the demand or supply side instruments, which I'll cover later. The contractual terms, provider payments and incentive mechanisms, monitoring and accountability systems. So these are some of the elements of strategic purchasing: population health, cost-effective contracting, citizen empowerment, strengthening stewardship and capacity, developing effective purchaser and provider organizations. So these are some of the examples in international literature of strategic purchasing for chronic disease screening and management. So you can see that, in fact, all countries, irrespective of the different types of health systems, tax-based, social health insurance, market-based, and mixed systems, all have programs to look at purchasing for chronic disease screening and management. And we then reviewed the government policies to engage the private sector, the PPPs, and the three main policies implemented: PPPs from the private sector, regulation of private homes, and introduction of voluntary health insurance schemes. So we looked at the purchaser, the different purchaser for different programs, and then assessed them. When we look at the financing mechanisms, there are two main financing mechanisms. One is so-called supply side, and the other is the demand side. The supply side looks at giving resources to the provider. It motivates change in health providers to improve individual access. The beneficiary is the provider. The tools are incentive and payment guaranteed providers, such as capitation payments, fee-for-service, performance-based payment, and referral vouchers. And for our systems in Hong Kong, our general outpatient clinic and the PPPs done by the HA are demand supply-side instruments. The demand side stimulates individuals, particularly underserved people, to demand. So it's really you drive consumption for health service to increase utilization and access to underutilized services. So the beneficiary is a patient, and it's through financial subsidies and incentives such as vouchers and cash transfers. So our elderly health voucher and some of the other programs of vaccination are examples of the demand side instruments. When we looked at the evaluating Hong Kong's efforts in PPP, when we look at some of the supply side prohibitors and demand side prohibitors, and looked at the system prohibitors, One of the key things we found was lack of integration between primary and specialty care, between public and private. So we have isolated programs, but the connections and linkages are not there. There's sometimes inadequate provider incentives and inadequate subsidies for patients for certain programs. And then one of the things was the complaint was about demanding administrative procedures. I wanted to cover this, in fact, I've covered it before, to really demonstrate the need for strategic purchasing. This is the elderly voucher that has been launched in government. And maybe, as you know, that we're spending about $3 billion each year for the elderly voucher. When this is based on studies that we did, and look at the voucher claims for Western medical conditions. So you can see the proportion in pink are the ones for acute management of acute conditions. The ones in blue are for chronic conditions, and the top one are the preventive. So in fact, there's very little money which is being spent on prevention and from chronic disease, so it's mainly acute. But more importantly, when you look at the whether they usually consult public or private doctors, before using the voucher, you can see that 73% use the public, as you would expect for chronic disease, and 22% use private only, right? And 49% use both public and private. But when after using the voucher, the number of people that kept on just public or private decreased. So for 17 for public and 19 for private. And what happened is that 61% then utilized both public and private. So what you've done is to generate greater demand from the private sector, but has not decreased the demand on the public sector. And these are figures that we had, looking at the voucher users and non-users. The voucher users are in blue, and the non-voucher users are in red. And you can see that there's absolutely no difference in their utilization of our public outpatients, whether they were voucher users or not. And this is data also about voucher users. When you look at the general outpatient clinics over time, the number of voucher users that use outpatients have not changed. What has happened is that the people that use the public sector, private sector has changed. So voucher is a consumer-led demand-side financing tool. So it's like our consumption voucher. It encourages consumption. It's more effective if it's targeted at a specific group for a specific health service that's well-defined and time-limited, and in part of those services which are underutilized. One of the problems with the voucher design is that it's not well-defined. So patients don't know what primary care is, so they have a whole range of things. So they're going in terms of primary care, and it's not helping the system. So it's very good for the consumer, right? So they have a choice in terms of what they want. But it doesn't do anything in terms of efficiency of the system. It just drives up consumption, and then also it has some impact on driving up costs, because the individuals that use the voucher do not have to pay for it. So this is just the summary of the purchasing of primary care in Hong Kong. You can see the amount has increased dramatically, right? So we've looked at the programs, the family medicine specialists, the outpatient clinics. It has gradually increased, but we then also have the voucher use in the bottom, elderly health voucher, vaccine programs. So those have all increased dramatically. So the amount of money we put into primary care, as Chief Executive said, for development has increased substantially. So we then look at a study in terms of supply and strategic purchasing, chronic disease management, screening and management. So we use this as an example of how strategic purchasing can be more targeted for screening and management. So we applied it to look for health system goals. Two principles, chronic disease screening voucher, and then a disease management scheme. So methodology is from key stakeholders, population survey, and economic analysis. Who to purchase? The government. For whom? Adults between 45 to 54. What to purchase and whom? We propose a screening for high lipids screening, chronic disease management, diabetes and hypertension, and follow up with family doctors how to purchase would be a hybrid model. The demand side instrument would to fully subsidize the voucher because you really then it's targeted. But we need a supply side instrument, which is performance based, to offer providers to manage services which finances flexibility and for co-payments to be determined. So it's a mix using two instruments. When we did the population survey, 75% respondents without a prior diagnosis we expect willing to participate. Physical accessibility was reported to be important and convenience of location. Financial affordability was a factor in their decision for regular screening, and 58% attributed reasonable service pricing at primary or secondary consideration. And insufficient in affordability and without insurance were likely to use the public sector for screening and management. But individuals were also willing to pay. So we asked them whether they were willing to pay for chronic disease. And you can see that it's quite a number of people, in fact 75% of respondents willing to pay for chronic disease conditions ranging from 51 to 500. So in the middle bar would be people willing to pay 100 to 200, 31.5%. So we also did this an economic analysis, looking at the different progression of disease in terms of progression rate. So these assumptions I won't go into detail for time. And we looked at two scenarios, scenario one and two. Scenario two really was looking at the costs associated with the program in the hospital authority, the risk assessment management program for chronic disease, and on the scenario one is the standard outpatient costs. So just to summarize, what we found that there were cost savings over 30 years for scenario one, which is the general outpatient costs of 31 billion costs, and then scenario two would be more expensive because of the more specialized. But the savings were more substantial for scenario two. Of course, we also had a decrease in mortality and for diabetes and pre-diabetes in the two scenarios. And the total prevented mortality was 28,700 for scenario one, 47,000 for the RAM program. And the cost to prevent one death was over a million for scenario one and 696,000 for scenario two. So finally, I just want to go on to the recommendations. We should apply strategic purchasing and leverage public-private partnerships as a purchasing instrument with a strategic vision to improve primary care accessibility in Hong Kong. So these are the steps of what service to purchase, whether to provide or purchase, for whom, from whom, who to purchase, and how to purchase. So we also thought that Hong Kong should consider introducing the chronic disease screening voucher and management program to enhance primary care accessibility. So one age group that we would investigate was 45 to 54, but it could also apply to the elderly health voucher. So that could be the start of using the healthy life voucher to construct a screening and management program. And these are the components when government is considering strategic purchasing, looking at components to be considered: population health, citizens' empowerment, strengthening government stewardship and capacity, developing effective purchaser-provider organizations, and in corporate cost-effective contracting. And finally, I just want to cover this, which is the key part of how strategic purchasing can be implemented for achieving an integrated care system to enable health for all. So in this systems level of strategic purchasing, there are three levels of the health system. The first is the so-called governance or the policy level, which is the macro. The second would be the purchaser-provider systems, the meso level. And then the third, importantly, the actual delivery at the personal January. So when we look at the macro level, for search to function, there are four key functions that need to be looked at. One is how to governance. Second, the policy parameters for providers. Third, collaboration oversight. So it needs to be informed by population needs assessment in conjunction with evaluation of delivery systems. So to look at where the gaps are in the delivery system as part of the governance. And deciding the policy instruments to enable implementation. And if one decides that the purchaser is not the government, then policy parameters have to be set for the purchaser in terms of the contracting commission, the policy guidance, authorization, for the purchases to managed services and the objectives and goals. And of course, importantly, there needs a system of oversight and accountability, looking at licensing and accreditation, monitoring, evaluation, reviewing, and audit. At the major level, the purchasing commission and provider systems needs to be looked at the roles and authority and obligations of the purchases, the engagement with governments to align functions, structures for communication and collaboration with the stakeholders, and looking at how services should be integrated, the mixed type settings and providers of care, networking of services and agreements for resource deployment, and bridging mechanisms, and looking at the systems for coordination, which would be facilitated by care paths, clinical protocols, and multidisciplinary team engagement. Of course, importantly, is how to monitor results, process reviews, performance monitoring, and patient feedback. Of course, at the person level, would be enable the individual to have a seamless journey in care delivery across preventive, curative, rehabilitative, palliative, and social care. It needs to be considered bridging and coordinating mechanisms to be considered in the purchasing process to enable so-called vertical integration of care and horizontal between specialities, between social and medical care, and transitions to and from the community. So finally, in terms of strategic purchasing to enabling health for all, for our system to be fit for purpose for the 21st century, a strategic goal for transformation to primary care-led integrated person care health system is critical. Strategic purchasing is a critical lever to enable resources to be effectively allocated to meet system goals and population needs should be incorporated in health system governance functions, enable better resource utilization, fostering closer integration and healthcare development of primary, secondary, and tertiary care, and coordination with social care. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Yeo. Please have a seat. Lunch will now be served. Our symposium will resume at 1:40. Please enjoy.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will now resume our program. May I now invite you all to watch a video that summarizes the highlights of our report. Please enjoy.
Hong Kong's health system continues to be challenged by a rapidly aging population. 2019 population data shows that high blood pressure, diabetes, and high cholesterol, collectively termed three highs, have become the most prevalent chronic conditions. These healthcare demands greatly increase the financial and personnel resource strain to the health system, compromising our health system sustainability. Our Hong Kong Foundation's 2018 Health Policy Research Report proposed that Hong Kong's health system move towards a person-centered, primary care-led, and integrated health system. Importantly, integrated care promotes people's timely access to a spectrum of preventive, curative, rehabilitative, to palliative care across the life course and across care settings. However, the necessary system transformation is hindered as our health system resources are not strategically allocated to meet population health needs. To accelerate the development of a health system that prioritizes services based on population health needs and integrates care throughout the life course, we put forward four policy directions, which include six decisions, five dimensions, and three system levels considerations. Direction 1, Hong Kong should apply strategic purchasing to health services planning. Strategic purchasing is recognized by the World Health Organization as a critical health financing lever for improving healthcare quality and increasing financial risk protection. In this report, Strategic Purchasing Enabling Health for All, the Foundation demonstrates how strategic purchasing can be applied to make primary care for chronic disease more affordable and accessible. Direction 2, Hong Kong should introduce a chronic disease screening voucher and management scheme for the three highs. The Foundation's economic analysis finds that if the health system implements the scheme for diabetes screening and management for those aged 45 to 54 at scheme entry, over 30 years, the health system will save approximately 12.5 billion Hong Kong dollars on direct healthcare expenses and prevent approximately 47,000 premature mortalities. We recommend that the government apply six key decisions of strategic purchasing. Decision 1, whether to provide or purchase. After taking into account the constrained capacity in the public sector, the Foundation recommends the government to purchase private sector services for chronic disease screening and management. Decision 2, who to purchase. The government should identify a purchaser of the scheme to implement the scheme and coordinate it with other primary care efforts. Decision 3, for whom to purchase. The Foundation recommends that the scheme target individuals in the 45 to 54 age group upon scheme entry to prevent the onset and reduce worsening of chronic conditions. Decision 4, what to purchase. The Foundation recommends that the purchaser buy screening and follow-up management services in the private sector. For users without a three highs diagnosis, the purchaser should buy rescreening services and at least one follow-up consultation with family doctors. Decision 5, from whom to purchase. The Foundation recommends that the purchaser buy from private family doctors, who should serve as the first contact point for other primary care services. Decision 6, how to purchase. The Foundation recommends that the scheme employ both demand and supply side incentives. On one hand, use a voucher mechanism to fully subsidize screening. On the other hand, use provider incentives for follow-up management services. Direction 3, health system strategic purchasing should be implemented for achieving an integrated care system to enable health for all. Beyond primary healthcare development, the Foundation recommends the government to consider the application of strategic purchasing across three levels: the health system level, healthcare delivery purchaser provider system, and person journey of healthcare delivery in a coordinated manner. At the macro level, the government should strengthen governance, establish policy parameters, boost multi-stakeholder collaboration, and strengthen oversight and accountability. At the MISO level, the government should define the purchasing, commissioning, and provider system, enable the integration of health services, develop systems for coordination, and monitor results. At the micro level, the government should develop an integrated, person-centered, and holistic care model using purchasing contracts, monitoring, and evaluation. Direction 4. The government must consider five key policy dimensions to ensure effective application of strategic purchasing. At the macro level, strengthening government stewardship and capacity. The Foundation recommends the government to name a central purchaser of the scheme and clarify its role, which includes ensuring this scheme and other purchasing programs are coordinated with each other, regularly releasing expenditure and performance reports. At the MISO level, developing effective purchaser and provider organizations. The Foundation recommends the government to assess and ensure sufficient private sector capacity to meet new service demands. The purchaser should collaborate with stakeholders from the private and public sectors, such as the district health centers. At the micro level, increasing citizen empowerment. The Foundation's population-based survey findings show that 66% and 60% of respondents factor in the price of services when deciding to screen and receive follow-up care respectively. The Foundation recommends that the purchaser fully subsidize screening and involve patients in setting up co-payment for disease management. Dimensions that operate throughout system levels include incorporating population health. Strategic purchasing decisions are needs-based, so collecting and analyzing population health data are critical. The Foundation recommends that the government strengthen existing electronic infrastructure, such as the electronic health record sharing system, to integrate data across sectors. Incorporating cost-effective contracting. The Foundation recommends the government to create an individualized care protocol for patients with three highs in the private sector. The scheme must define risk-sharing expectations between the public and private sectors and require that quality standards be met for contract renewal. As Hong Kong will face more healthcare challenges, the Foundation recommends that strategic purchasing should serve as a development framework for realizing the vision of an integrated healthcare system, enabling Hong Kong to truly achieve health for all.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, now is the time for another highlight of the symposium. We will hear from our renowned panel members. Each bring unique expertise and insight on developing a fit-for-purpose health system that's primary care-led, person-centered, and integrated. May I please invite Professor Yeo, Mr. Henry Fan, Professor Donald Lee, and Mr. Tim Peng back to the stage. This remarkable panel will be moderated by Dr. Stephen Wong.
Okay, thanks so much. Thanks everybody for coming. And also we have a delightful session with our esteemed panelists. Maybe I first ask each of our panelists, Tim, Henry, Donald first, to sort of give us a couple minutes of sort of remark and response or thoughts to sort of our report recommendations, and particularly, sort of, what do you think the strategic purchasing? You know, why is that important, or do you think it's important in sort of propelling the health system transformation in Hong Kong? So may I ask maybe this way, Donald?
Thank you for the opportunity. First of all, I congratulate the Foundation for an excellent report, very comprehensive, and really looking at to, you know, some of the gaps or health provision inefficiencies. I think it's all agreed that primary care is very important to alleviate the stress on our healthcare system. But we look at four aspects, which I think the report covers, the essence of primary care. Number one is, of course, the end user. Health-seeking behavior, hazards. And I think this has been well covered in your report. For example, to target high-risk groups. But I think quite important is also to change the health-seeking behavior through education and all that, so that they still do not flock to hospitals, you know, for primary care and all that. But still, that has to do with the other factors as I talk about. The second is the provider, basically delivering primary care. And, you know, it has mentioned a lot about family doctors, which is wonderful. But, you know, primary care is also a team approach led by family doctors. I think patients still want to see a doctor. But to have the support of the team of the ancillary care and all that would be the way to move people, shift back to the community. And I think, you know, that has been also mentioned. But also the provider-wise, I think it's quite important to establish trust by the end users so that they feel comfortable in seeing the so-called family doctors, that they're providing safe and high-quality service and all that. The third thing is the financing, of course, which is very well covered, which I think strategic purchasing is really very good. I've always been questioning the problem of provider purchases split, you know, the provider being the same one as the purchaser, and I think this has been addressed. Especially, I'm really happy to see, you know, the use of private resources to purchase from the private sector as such. So I think that is well covered as well. But lastly, most important is also the stewardship, which has been mentioned as well in the report. How to administer all this? Who holds the funds? How to ensure service is delivered? So again, you know, I think, you know, with the primary care forthcoming report and all that, hopefully this can be addressed as well. So that's
thanks,
all for
Donald.
Me. Yeah.
Henry?
First of all, Stephen, many congratulations on your successful election to LegCo yesterday.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. I too would echo what Donald said in terms of offering my congratulations to both the foundation and particularly Professor Yeo for an excellent report. Now, speaking personally, I agree with all the four recommendations in this report, following on with the 2018 report. However, I do think that going forward, we would have to address two issues in order to implement the recommendations in the report. The first one is manpower. I think government would have to supplement, or the foundation would have to supplement this report with a manpower policy. Because what the recommendation means is, in the long run, it would alleviate our medical health system, for sure, with primary care. But in the interim, what we're suggesting is, in fact, to be more preventive, and therefore to have more patients utilizing the medical services in Hong Kong. I mean, it can be in the private sector or it can be in the public sector, but more people will be using medical services. Therefore, there will be more constraint on the lack of medical professionals, which we are already facing today. I'm sure Tony will have more headache retaining his people once this is implemented. So we would have to supplement this report with a manpower policy for Hong Kong, medical manpower policy for Hong Kong, as we move forward. In the long run, It will save us money, as the report said, but in the short run, we need to resolve a lot of problems. So this is my first point. The second point, which Donald also touched upon, is of course the question of money. How are we going to finance all of this? Now, the chief executive has already said that during her reign, she has increased hospitals authorities' funding by 45% between 2017 and 2021. Now, with these recommendations, more funds will be needed. Government, even if we ask people to co-pay, there would still be financing requirements. So we will have to resolve the financing issues before we decide to proceed. How are we going to, in other words, how is Hong Kong going to finance these additional initiatives? I have no ready answer, but there are ways to look at it. Co-payment is one way. I recall many years ago when I was sitting on an advisory committee for Dr. Yok Chow to look at medical insurance. We came up with a recommendation that there should be mandatory, compulsory medical insurance for everybody in Hong Kong. Now, unfortunately, that recommendation, for political reasons, was eventually not adopted. And what we have today is a voluntary medical insurance scheme. Is it time now for us to revisit this issue? Now that we have professionals like Stephen on our LegCo, they could perhaps be more understanding and be more accommodating. These are some of the thoughts that came to my mind as I listened to the introduction of this report. But I think two issues, in short, manpower and financing. Thank you.
Thanks, Henry. I will just give Professor your heads up. I will pass the mic to you after Tim.
唔好介意我用廣東話去回應，因為我想即係比較貼地啲同埋傳神啲去分享一下我哋喺前線接觸好多基層市民同埋長期病患者嘅時候咧，佢哋嗰個經歷。咁我諗有一個故事都想同大家分享一下，我估亦都回應到所謂呢個 strategic purchase 嗰個目的嘅。即係有一日我同同事傾開，即係佢哋嗰個工作啦咁。咁同事話咧，就喺板印房度探到一個長者60多歲。咁啊，佢話成日都頭暈，咁啊好好啦，因為佢喺旺角區住嘅，啱啱咧就旺角區油尖旺就開咗個地區康健站啊嘛，咁啊趁機又試下個服務睇下點樣啦咁，咁去到即係接受嗰個評估啦，就發現哇原來佢糖尿咧超標，去到14.5咁犀利，咁啊即刻就諗住轉介佢睇專科啦。大家都知道，即係一睇等專科都等好長時間噶嘛，咁啊起碼都等緊係即係半年到先至睇到個內科啊個專科。咁點算咧？等緊期間，咁點都要即係用藥噶。咁可唔可以即係用啊？因為佢長者嘛，咁可唔可以用啲醫療券去睇下醫生先，或者做下啲檢查先咧？咁啊，原本是一個好諗法嚟嘅，但係問個長者，誒、哎、你咪有幾千蚊醫療券嘅？咁啊，長者就話係啊。我攞咗佢攞包花膠出嚟，2000多蚊包花膠，跟住啊，咁你都仲有2000多蚊啦，咁點啊？跟住攞包冬菇出嚟，包冬菇都差唔多1000蚊，啊係啊，就用咗啦。咁喂，咁都仲有1000蚊，點都可以睇一睇醫生啩？佢話唔係啊，有一日即係順便去藥材行行下，跟住又有人搲住佢，喂，我哋咧可以咧兑換呢個醫療券。即係兑翻個現金俾你啊！咁啊兑咗啦，兑咗之後就即係買一啲唔知啲健康補品咁樣啦。咁跟住咧就自己又袋一啲錢咧，就可以補貼下日常嗰個生活啊咁。咁呢個咧就正正就係而家好似頭先啊Professor Yao 咁講，即係當你係一個即係 demand side 嘅 strategy 去提供呢一個咁樣嘅服務嘅時候咧，佢哋嗰個使用咧。當他不知道、不懂得那個用途的時候、那個目的的時候，他就不知道、哦、原來怎樣用法才對他們自己的健康最好的。結果呢、就是、就是有些無良、商人或者自己不懂用的時候呢，就用在這些這樣的地方身上了。我估如果整個所謂這個 strategic purchase 是真的 做得到、做得好嘅話咧，嗱，第一，我諗呢個長者唔會去到六十幾歲先發現自己糖尿病咁超標，可能好早期咧，即係45歲，即係真係做到啲健康檢查咧，已經可以開始留意住嗰個身體狀況啦。咁跟住咧，可能有啲定期檢查咧，就令到佢保持住、維持住嗰個健康，亦都唔會咧令到政府原本用嗰、那個醫療券，希望啲長者咧透過啲檢查去維持自己健康，結果咧就係即係益咗啲無良商人，或者令到即係呢啲老友記即係嘅食完冬菇花膠都唔特別會健康咗嘅啊。咁我覺得呢個都係喺前線我哋觀察咧，實際上係有呢個需要喺度。
Thank you, Peng, Tim, for the illustrative stories. So back to Professor Yeo about the two points from Henry on manpower and also financing. So I guess just to chime in, obviously, I think, Henry, you also agree that in the long run, we're going to save money by doing this. But what you're saying is, in the short term, you know, inevitably, it will incur a bit more expenses first to actually reap the reward afterwards. Is
exactly.
It fair to...
We must bear in mind that there can be no long-term without short-term. So we got to resolve the short-term issue as well as the long-term together.
Okay. Professor Yeo?
Okay. I just want to point out that we did this summary, but obviously I didn't highlight the figures. From 2017 to 18, the total public expenditure of primary care was 8.9 billion. By 2021, by a calculation, obviously this is based on public figures, some is not exactly primary care, it's 22.8 billion, right? So we had more than double, it's almost treble the amount of money. But is it money well spent? I think the chief executive herself talked about the district health system. And the elderly voucher, I think Tim has already mentioned, it's done nothing for the system. So if we had a better strategic purchasing system, this sort of problems would not arise because you would have dealt with the problem, right? So going forward, I think government should really seriously consider looking at those parameters and developing capacity. And importantly, what government has not recognized is the need for integrated care. So in the government's webpage, they talk about two strategic objectives, primary care and the purchasing from the private sector. But what's missing is integrative care, which is important because if you do not do that, you're going to duplicate care, and there are going to be gaps. So it's gaps in duplication of care, duplication of services. So that needs to be factored in as a key part of the system. And the point about, Mr. Fang talked about the resources and the manpower. When we did this study, there's not a problem with the screening, because screening is quite easy to do. But if government wants to do the chronic disease management, our studies are really just an example. We need to do much more work to look at different scenarios because we did not look at, because many people already are under treatment. There are a certain number, probably 20 or 30%, that may be unknown, but they're going to turn up in the system. So upfront, you're right that you have an additional number of people. And then looking at capacity in the private sector, I'm sure that's a capacity. You don't need to do it in the public sector. So you pick up diseases earlier. And primary care, as Donald was saying, is not just about doctors. It's a primary care team. So what's Singapore? Singapore, in fact, has a screening program and a chronic disease program. And the government funds for people below the median household income. So the others do it all the same. So government then provides those resources for people below the median income. And what they've done is they contract with groups of doctors, right? So they're forming networks. So they recognize for chronic disease management cannot be done by a single, Donald was saying, by a single person. You need primary care development needs to look at groups of doctors, right, in future that provide multidisciplinary care. So Singapore has actually, what they've done, they contract with and they encourage doctors to form networks and they help them develop the capacity. And in fact, when I was in the secretary, one of the one of the reasons why we said we want to transfer the hospitals to the HA was to integrate care. But also at that time, my concept was that one third of the facilities could be used for training family doctors to provide, because family doctors are six years. So 4 years, they can then provide services and you can then help them develop the systems as a training for these. They can be then private providers. HA can then let out the premises to them, so they then start groups of doctors. So you, as you're right, you need to train people. You need to form that network. So what we're doing is that we just put it on the cards, but we are not suggesting that this is something that's going to be easily done, but it needs to be considered. Because it's a question of that if government has some money in the future, when resources are better, it's something you can consider. Maybe not now, and you can build up the time, do the more research, looking at the feasibility. So you need more research in that area. So it's not something that we know that we just produce that just based on some published surveys and budget analysis, but much more work needs to be done.
I also, maybe Donald can talk about the capacity issue as well.
The two things, you know, actually I'd like to add some comments, which are linked to actually manpower and finance. Manpower, actually, family doctors are trained. You know, continuity is an important thing. So in chronic disease management, in screening and all that, it's part of the job. It's a matter of whether they want to do it. Is there enough incentive for them to do it? So there's something else you have to look at from the finance point of view. But also, I think the sense of responsibility for one's health is also very important. And that is linked to financing. That's why, you know, I agree that we may want to explore sort of mandatory medical insurance, or even actually at a point I was involved in a study on mandatory savings plan, like the one in Singapore, which can be passed on to second generation and all that. But all this will, I think, help change patients' health-seeking behavior so that they don't rely on government, you know, everything is government paying and all that. And that's why this report is so good, you know, the strategic purchasing is targeting on needs and also to make use of all the resources.
Donald, can you elaborate a bit more on the incentive that can sort of mobilize the private doctors?
Well, first of all, you know, in the old days, untrained specialists were GPs, so they were looked upon, you know, as sort of the lower grade, you know, service provider. So number one, I think a recognition of their status as a specialist is an incentive so that patients and the public realize that these are trained sort of primary care doctors in family medicine and they can provide. So that's one incentive is the recognition. And the second, of course, is the financial incentive. Right now, it's very difficult in a way in the PPP programs and all that. I think partially because of the expense of drugs, you know, and pharmacy. Consultation fees, I think, are limited and doctors are quite happy, you know, with a proper recognition. But programs that need to ask them to include medication would be quite difficult. And hence, you know, we see some light in the district health centers. If we can start, you know, seeing how they can truly support to provide holistic care by the family doctor and also re-explore the concept of community pharmacies, you know, to separate the prescription so that the expense of the medication can be borne partially, for example, by government.
Can I ask you a sensitive question? From a private doctor perspective, do you think, you know, from private doctor perspective, do you think the HA doctors are quite collaborative in the PPP programs?
No, I think definite improvement over the years. You know, gradually they realize, and that's why I talk about recognition. I think the specialists, the hospital-based doctors now realize the role of the primary care doctors. So I think the mutual respect is a lot, and this is most important. Before, I think, say 20 years ago, hospital-based doctors were reluctant to provide any information, you know, after admission. You know, they think this is the GP that threw the case in and all that. But now, with the e-health record, with better communication and understanding of family medicine, I think things have improved.
Professor Yeo, is there anything we can do to help HA doctors to be more, even more collaborative with the PPP programs?
I think it's both the management systems. It's really the understanding and the engagement and people understanding what the objective is and how it helps them. I don't see that the doctors in Asia are necessarily not collaborative. I think they're obviously because they're different doctors in different programs, and some of them really are not involved in it. But I'm sure they appreciate the value of the collaboration. So maybe it's just some of the communication problems and engagement, because when we did the research on PPP that Professor Eliza Wong did, so it's really a matter of, it's about implementation and the design. So when in many programs, because it's also what Bureau is now very keen about, implementation science. Implementation science, the problem is that when you have a good program, it's the program is that fails for two reasons. One, it's not based on good designs and evidence. The second is implemented poorly. And of course, implementation is very important in terms of developing the so-called implementation strategy, engagement of people in the design. Because when you design something, there are always going to be problems in different contexts. So when you engage people early in the design, then you reduce some of those problems. And of course, then also the understanding that in the implementation process itself is very, very complex, and that you need to then look at the problems and adjust as you go along, and not evaluate 3 years later, because the problems are already there. So this is so-called the formative evaluation that you do. And it's many of the issues are about communications. It's about building the relationships, understanding the problems on the other side, right? So Asia has a perspective in terms of this is what we want, this is how we should do it, and you follow it, right? So that, I'm not suggesting that, but that's sort of the impression that the private doctors have. So I guess it's collaboration is something that can be built. So you need to really understand some of these issues.
Can I speak out in defense of HA? First of all, I think it's an overstatement to say that HA doctors are uncooperative. I think the PPP section in HA has been cautious, is my impression. When they first started the program, they set up very strict governance rules, checking performance, assessing qualifications and all that. Therefore, creating quite a bit of administrative burden for the scheme. But I wouldn't call that uncooperative, you see. Insofar as the front lines are concerned, they are really only executing head office policy. And I can also assure you that in the past 2 years, we have been doing our best to try to simplify the administrative process with a view to do exactly what Donald and Professor envisage, that we should cooperate more with the private doctors, you see. A second issue is the question of how much we can afford to pay. Now, we have received a lot of representation that our rate is too low, that it's not attractive, that we should increase it, and so forth and so on. But then we do have public interest to consider, you see. So that may be another area of contention when private doctors consider HA to be uncooperative. You know, I think that is actually what happened. But moving forward, we do intend to do more PPP. But again, we are faced with some constraints. The top one of which is, would more PPPs result in more of our doctors leaving HA to go into private practice? Now, this is a vicious circle, you see. So unless we can resolve this issue once and for all, we are hesitant at this point of time to expand PPP by a very large scale. That is the point we are trying to do. Now, it is possible that if we do PPP in another format, that risk may be minimized. And what we are considering now is, for instance, collaborate more with GBA hospitals, collaborate more with Hong Kong Shenzhen Hospital, Hong Kong U Shenzhen Hospital. Ask them to take over some of our cases, or ask them to do some imaging for us. Because if we do that, the risk of our doctors leaving HA is minimized. This is one area we are looking into, you see. But we need to resolve our manpower retention issue before we are comfortable with moving strides ahead on PPP projects.
我都想回應一個有關於嗰個頭先講溝通嘅問題。我諗除咗係 HA 同埋 私家之間個溝通講 PPP 之外咧，其實 HA 同病人啊個服務使用者個溝通咧都緊要嘅。其實一出一啲新嘅 PPP program 咧，都總會有啲老友記即係揸住一沓信嚟問我哋，其實講咩㗎？即係嚇，咁裏面好多表格啊，即係有好多資料啊咁樣。咁我哋解一輪，哦，原來咧嗱，因為你排隊排一段好長時間啦，咁跟住咧，而家醫管局有個咁樣嘅服務，咁你可以咧就出去睇私家啦。咁即係我哋都要協助佢解釋一輪咧，佢先至再去決定即係出唔出去。咁但係呢個過程，那個決定過程咧。 其實有陣時啦，因為老友記都第一，佢等咯，都一段時間啦。咁佢有陣時會擔心就係去私家會唔會好貴咧？個費用自己承擔唔起咧。第二咧就係佢如果已經入咗醫管局啦，等緊個服務啦，咁佢都等一段時間啦，其實佢又未必太介意咧，就再等落去嘅。咁嗱，即係我估以往做 PPP 咧，都係一個叫清隊尾嘅一個策略，係咪？即係你排到好好尾啦。 咁嗰啲人即係都等一段時間啦，佢可能未必太介意再等嘅。咁除咗清隊尾之外，另外一個策略嘅方向會唔會係所謂你未入嗰條隊嘅時候咧，都要清咧，你減即係減縮短嗰條隊咧？嗱，因為一啲未入去醫管局去等緊服務嘅病人咧，可能佢個意欲即係喺盡快喺私營嗰度攞個服務咧，係會大啲嘅。咁所以即係我諗，除咗係等一段時間嘅病人。 即係有個邀請，而呢個邀請希望咧能夠即係講解得清楚啲，能夠明白其實係做啲咩之外咧。另外就係未入條隊嘅，可能都要有啲策略，即係用啲方法，即係 PPP 咁樣轉移喺 私家嗰度去接受個服務咯。
I still have tons of questions to follow up, but I would like to open up to the floor to see if you any of you would like to join the discussions to give a comment or to particularly raise a question to our panelists. We have mic runners on the floor, so if you can, if you like, just raise your hands and we'll see you, and then you can ask that question. If not, I will also ask Professor Yeo your response first. Do you support mandatory medical insurance, like what Henry just discussed? And second, I think, so Henry repeatedly sort of talks about the concern for stress, giving additional stress to hospital authority for the PPP program, which, even though we are really talking about primary care, even though we are not just talking about primary care, but it's one of the emphasis of the report is primary care. Even though we're stressing primary care, you seem to still have a big concern for the
so far. I'm of less concern when talking about primary care.
Right.
I was referring to PPP in general.
Hospital care.
Because
okay.
There was some allegation that our doctors have not been cooperative. I was speaking out in defense
okay.
of that. So
okay.
But that aside,
yeah.
In terms of primary care, I mean, hospital authority would welcome if a decision is taken to take primary care basically off HA and let us concentrate on secondary and tertiary. I mean, that's our mission. After all, we are hospital authority managing hospitals. We are not supposed to be doing GOPC. But for historical reasons, it was given to hospital authority and we have continued
That's
with
even
it.
A bigger discussion now.
You see,
so Professor Yeo, you have a view on sort of taking primary care from hospital authorities.
Let's talk about medical insurance. I think certainly when you look at providing universal access, so really an equitable system where people don't suffer financial hardship because of having to pay for healthcare. I think that's all of us think that's a good thing, right? There are only two systems that can do it. One is by social health insurance. The second is tax-based systems. So it's a question of in tax-based systems whether you spend enough or not. In your tax-based systems, although we say we have put a lot in, but when you look at the amount of money, it's in total health expenditure in Hong Kong, half is public, half is private, and the other half in the private is mainly out of pocket, and it's very inefficient, right? So really, one needs to look at the system's efficiency and what are the mechanisms. So if you do not want to change your system, so you can change your social insurance, but there have been so many attempts since the Harvard report in 1989. So every time you go, people don't want to pay. So really, it's not so easy to change the financing system. Some countries have done it, but there are contexts in terms of when you can do it. Right? So we haven't reached a stage where, in my view, if you suddenly ask people to contribute, they're not going to. It's a no-go. Unless there's a crisis, right? Unless something's happening, unless you take opportunities. So if you do not do that, then you need to look at your tax-based system. How can you use your resources better? And you need to look at the public and private as one system. So the segmentation is a problem. So if you have two segments, how do the two segments work? People just go between the two systems, and that's the inefficiency. So how can you use our system, look at the total resources in our system? Not even the out-of-pocket is also part of the solution, right? So that would be the insurance that government has done to try to get private insurance to be more full risk. But there's things you can't touch in the private sector because people can go. But the biggest problem that we have is primary care. So hospital care, the proportion in private sector is very small. So people are rich, they can pay for it. And better pay transparency like our CU Medical Center is doing, where people know what they're going to pay, it's affordable. Many people are willing to go. So Wong Hong is building up, he's now CEO, and he's building up the capacity. So I think we need to have a different mechanisms, right? If we don't want to then change the financing system, which I don't think is going to be possible anyway, then we need to look at the different levers, right? So it's not just one simple thing that you look at. And in the hospital authority, the biggest problem is the community care, the social care, the support to patients, the readmissions. 20% readmissions within 30 days. It just looks at the failure of the post-discharge support. So if you were able to deal with that, the hospital authority would reduce the demand. If you have better primary care, better people that can take the load off the system, that would also be a great boom to the system. So you have the two ends. So if you separate it, it's going to be more difficult to coordinate. The reason why I was the one that put the primary care into the hospital authority. Right? Yes, when Margaret Chan was director of health, she wanted to have extension, and I negotiated with her to say Department of Health should not provide services. They should only be regulators and the policy support to the Bureau and for public health functions. Because that's what's needed by the Bureau, I'm sure Dr. Choi would agree. Because in no country in the world, it's the Ministry of Health, does not have that technical arm. So every ministry, even in UK, the Chief Medical Officer is part of the ministry. But they don't have anyone there in the ministry. So you have a problem. So there's so many of these intertwined problems that need to be addressed. But the movement should be really providing better primary care and then better aftercare.
Just curious, at that point, why don't you change the ordinance of hospital authority?
The ordinance does not need to be changed.
Okay.
We looked at the hospital authority ordinance. It doesn't define what hospital services are. Okay? Right. So in fact, it doesn't, because it's a question of what hospital serves. I've looked at the ordinance. So that's why we moved the...
Well, I'm saying, why don't you change the name to health authority at that point?
It should be. Right? It should be a health authority. So the government is thinking about separate primary health authority. I suggested, why don't you have a health authority? And the HA can be the purchaser. The seven clusters can be providers. I'm sure Donald agrees with that. So the purchase provider split. So the hospital can be the health authority and then be the purchaser on behalf of government. And the seven clusters can compete for the population. Or even in some countries, you can even contract out one cluster to a private sector. So there are models in the world where you have private providers providing care for a catchment population. And in fact, I did tell the chairman that in Goingman, in fact, did ask me to do a population-based funding model, Tony knows, for the hospital authority in terms of doing a capitation model for the seven clusters based on needs. That report is with the HA, is sitting in the shelf, doing nothing, right?
So it could be used as a system. Even now, you could use it in terms of resource allocation to the seven clusters. And that would improve efficiency. It could improve competition, because you can have an effective population, and people can go to whichever cluster they think it provides the best care.
Harry, before you speak on behalf of, as an HH chairman, I'm just going to ask you, intellectually, don't you think what Professor Yeo said seems appealing? Just not as a chairman of HH First.
both as a chairman and as a non-chairman, it's appealing. It's appealing. But what I'm saying is, we cannot continue expansion at hospital authority without some limitation. I mean, we're already spending $80 billion a year and more. And if you keep on changing, giving us more and more work, we have manpower problem at the moment. We have lots of other issues. So I think it's a good, in my view, it's good if you split up primary care and secondary and tertiary care, split it up. And I think government is doing a primary care blueprint. I hope the blueprint would go in that direction. I'm certainly not envisaging changing our name from hospital authority to health authority and then giving us more work because we can't cope with it.
Okay, any other questions, last questions? I just want to give you a chance. Thank you. May I ask you to each give less than 1 minute, 30 seconds? Oh, yes, 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 Arthur, yeah.
Can I just say the one thing that our speakers have not touched on is the general population. I think people trust the hospitals, trust the doctors in the hospital authority. They don't know about the general practitioners, right? So it's a question of trust. So if you ask a person, if you got ill, would you go to the hospital authority or would you go find a private practitioner? They don't know the private practitioner, but they trust the hospital authority. And this is why the load is loaded onto the hospital side rather than the private side.
Thank you, Arthur. And we owe this to our predecessors. In the last 30 years, they have worked very hard to build hospital authority into what it is today with an excellent reputation. And exactly for the same reason, myself and current management is very reluctant to take on more and more responsibilities unless we are certain we can maintain the same standard. But that is getting harder and harder with manpower shortage, with bed shortage, with increasing demand from the public, et cetera, you see. So that is why a solution has to be found for the hospital authority to be able to discharge our duties faithfully in the public interest and yet maintain the same reputation as our predecessors have worked so hard to earn for us.
Okay, we could have gone a lot more to discuss, but if I can ask each of our panelists to wrap it up, maybe 30 seconds or 1 minute of final thoughts to really help us to sort of synthesize all thoughts.
Well, as I started, you know, there are four issues: the provider, the end user, the finance, and then also the stewardship. You know, I think we touched all upon that. Arthur highlighted the second point, which I did talk about, is the standards, the trust between, you know, I think a lot has improved there. And then, you know, by training our family doctors. As before, it was untrained doctors that were GPs. And now we have the specialty of family medicine. We have international accreditation as such. But overall, just to sum up, I think this is excellent. You know, the strategy, the strategic purchasing is the way ahead. It addresses a lot of the problems that we have highlighted. It will provide actually incentive for private practitioners, so the scope of service will be widened and also looks at the needs and also prevention for the needy population. But the point I want to make is, you know, the stewardship. You know, I think, you know, a primary health care authority is really much needed at this point in time.
Thank you. Tim, the other side.
Okay. 我想剛才我們主要討論都是從一個 medical 或者 health 的角度去講, sorry, health for all 啦。 但我想我們調轉呢, 就今天都沒有特別去處理, 就是其實除了 health 係 medical 嘅有個 element 之外咧，另外 social 都係一個好重要 element 嚟嘅。咁我諗今日都比較少討論，不過CK 走咗啦，即係都好重要，就係喺個 social service 嗰邊點樣去 support 做到一個 health 咧。咁所以即係個題目除咗 health for all 之外咧，我覺得調翻轉 all for health 都係值得要諗嘅，就係、是、除咗medical side。Social side 又點樣 support 咧？點樣同個 community 去 engage 咧？咁大家一齊去做好呢件事，先至做到一個 health for all， 亦都係 all for health。
Thank you, Tim. Henry, your point is loud and clear, but
well, yes. Well, as I said, you know, I agree with the report. I think it's a great report. I agree with all the four recommendations, and it is now up to government to work out a roadmap and, if possible, a timeline, and the hospital authority is ready, willing, and able.To fully collaborate with the government to do so.
Thank you. Professor Yeo, your final words.
Yeah, I think I just want to say two short things. One is, of course, the problem is that Henry was saying, if you do more of the same, it's not going to solve the problem. So you need really to have a different paradigm, a different perspective, even within the HA, I would suggest. And the second, and of course, in the system is more important, how the system, the governance, so it really depends on the leadership of the government.To look at the roles of the private sector, the strategic purchasing, what are the anchors of that? What are the key things that we need to much more study in terms of, because we put very broad things in, but where are your priorities going to be? Which are the problems you want to address first? Right? Because you cannot do everything at the same time. So you need to have a much greater study for policy and then looking at the issues and then prioritize. So I think that's necessary. So what we've done is just put the concepts there.But much more work needs to be done, and that's why we always said that government should be funding policy research, right? Which is not currently being done, right? And the second would be what Tim was saying. What we have not covered are the social determinants of health. So our vice chancellor set up an institute for health equity, and that looks at so-called the social causes of health. There are many causes of health that emanate from social factors, right?So those are the upfront things, and the district health system should be doing that, addressing the social causation of health, right? The social factors, reaching out, looking at social determinants, and addressing them, and that's the upfront part, which we've not covered.
Thank you, Professor. With that, thanks so much for all the panelists, and we'll give it back to MC. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Yeo. Thank you, Professor Yeo, Professor Lee, Mr. Fang, Mr. Pang, and Dr. Wong. Please return to your seats. Thank you. Many thanks again to our incredible panel members for their edifying sharing. The discussion you've just heard will offer new insights on how to reshape our health financing structures to make it more strategic so that we may fully target the health needs of all in Hong Kong.To close this illuminating series of talks and discussions, I would now like to invite Dr. Choi, Undersecretary for Food and Health, onto the stage to deliver closing remarks. Dr. Choi, please.
Mrs. Chang, Professor Yeo, Professor Donald Lee, Mr. Henry Fang, Mr. Pang,Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Yeo for his invaluable contribution in the insightful health policy research paper, Strategically Purchasing Health for All, released today. In particular, I'm delighted to learn that our vision and mission, which will guide us in formulating a blueprint for the sustainable development of primary health care services in Hong Kong, are shared by Professor Yeo and his team.Primary health care system emphasizing prevention is of great importance to the population health. A comprehensive and coordinated primary health care system is the starting point of every individual's journey in the overall health care system. Our goal is to trigger a paradigm shift, guiding citizens to focus on disease prevention and health maintenance instead of curative services. With the concerted efforts of stakeholders at individual, organizational, and community levels,It is very encouraging that the establishment of the district health centers in all districts in Hong Kong has progressively materialized. As mentioned by the Chief Executive at her opening remarks,
the government will look to further promote medical social collaboration in our primary healthcare services. Funded by the government and operated by a non-governmental organization, DHC adopts a brand new service model which connects private medical and healthcare practitioners through a service network in the district. Through district-based services, public-private partnership, and medical social collaboration, DHC is a key component of the public healthcare system. With a multidisciplinary team comprising nurses, other health professionals, pharmacists, social workers, and support staff, DHC services are adjusted, taking into account the population distribution and health risk factors in the community with a view to enhancing public awareness of disease prevention and their capability in self-management of disease, of health. To this end, I must thank Professor Zhou and his research team of the CUHK in working together closely with the government to monitor and evaluate the services provided by the DHCs, including the quality and effectiveness of the service provided and service outlets of its network, customer feedback, and cost effectiveness. The government will take into account the result of Professor Yeo's study and the operational experience of the DHCs to enhance the operation model of the DHC scheme and to formulate the development direction of primary health care. The government is determined to respond to the health challenges brought about by the aging population and increasing chronic disease prevalence. Talking about chronic disease management, DHC provides screening services, diagnosis, and management programs of diabetes mellitus and hypertension to its members. In order to further enhance the measures to manage the chronic disease and alleviate the pressure on the public health care system, the government is actively preparing a pilot public-private partnership program in the Sham Shui Po DHC for launching in late December. Under this program, subsidized healthcare services will be provided through local network medical practitioners to DHC members who are newly diagnosed with diabetes or hypertension with a view to enhancing the public's capability in chronic disease management, thus alleviating the pressure on the public healthcare system. On public-private partnership program, the HA has introduced in the third quarter of 2021 a co-care service model to provide continual chronic disease management by private doctors in the community, riding on the established broad network of participating service providers under GPC-PPP. Under this new service model, HA specialist outpatient clinic patients who are in stable clinical conditions may choose to receive continuous chronic disease management by participating private doctors in the community. And a fast-track referral mechanism is also in place through which private doctors may refer patients with clinical needs back to HA for follow-up. The referred patients will not be taken as new cases and are not required to queue again for the services. I must thank Henry, Chairman of the Hospital Authority, who is here today, for HA's continued effort to tie in with the government's policy for promoting primary health care. As mentioned by the CE in her opening speech, the government has proceeded to formulate a blueprint for the sustainable development of primary health care services in Hong Kong under the guidance of the Steering Committee on Primary Health Care Development chaired by the Secretary of Food and Health. We are comprehensively reviewing the planning of primary health care services and governance framework, exploring several aspects in the blueprint, which we're not going into detail now. Among others, we have placed great emphasis on the role of DHCs as district primary healthcare hubs. Through active engagement of NHO partners, NGO partners, DHCs would be able to utilize its community and network and resources to promote district-based primary healthcare services that suit the community's need in a proactive and flexible manner. It will also strengthen medical social collaboration through a bottom-up approach. As for the review on financing of primary health care, the government will explore ways to conduct strategic purchasing for the primary health care services and review the positioning of existing government subsidized programs, including the elderly health care voucher scheme and the other primary health care PPP programs, in order to achieve a more strategic and cost-effective use of public resources. With the focus on primary health care services, a strategic plan will benefit patients to access subsidize primary healthcare services with a view to enhancing their self-awareness of health and prevention on chronic disease in the long run. The government aims to launch a blueprint within this term of the government. We will continue to foster cooperation across sectors and review the primary healthcare system to build a health-enhancing physical and social ecosystem and promote the health of all Hong Kong people. In closing, I would like to take the opportunity to thank the Our Hong Kong Foundation for organizing this insightful symposium and the very inspiring and thought-provoking discussion in the panel just now. Finally, the COVID-19 continued to ravage the world. Appeal to your support to share the message with your peers and friends to take the COVID-19 vaccine, be it first, second, or third doses, I suppose, as soon as possible, and encourage eligible persons under certain groups to receive the vaccine as soon as possible. And before my end, I would like to wish you a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Choi. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the symposium has now come to a close. Thank you for joining us. Should you be interested in revisiting today's event, please visit OHKF's Facebook page. Thank you all, and have a wonderful afternoon.